and guidance. He who is guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be taken astray by anyone. And he who is allowed by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be misguided cannot and will not be brought back to guidance by anyone on the face of this earth. I bear witness that there is no deity to be worshipped but Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and his last messenger, sent as a true guidance to humankind so that we could follow his example at all times, all places, and under all circumstances. You noticed that I slowed down as I was saying the last sentence because I need it for the rest of my presentation, that we do need guidance whenever we talk about elements of leadership. What kind of leadership? There are different kinds of leadership. We are seeking that kind of leadership that is through the example of our leader, our teacher, our muallim, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers and sisters, human beings by nature like and feel good whenever they are called by titles. That's the nature. Whenever someone is called Dr. so-and-so, he feels or she feels good. Whenever we see people who are in the military, they like to be called by their military titles. General, officer, whatever that title may be. In the academic world, professor, assistant professor, lecturer, whatever it is, titles mean a lot to people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing our nature, for the Muslims, He focused their attention on certain titles that they should train themselves to be very happy with only those titles. And we find them in the Quran, many titles. For example, you find such titles as At-Ta'ibun, Al-Abidun, Al-Sa'ihun, Al-Raki'un, Al-Sajidun. These are titles that indicate a certain degree of commitment to something that Islam likes to shape in our lives. There is a title that is so special that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned and followed by many number of ayat to describe why these people were called by such an honorable title. What is it? Ibadur Rahman. The servants of the most merciful. And you will say, but aren't we all? Indeed, we are. But some are servants forcefully. Others have developed that understanding of servitude in such a way that they took themselves to the height of deserving to be called true servants. These are the servants. This is the true meaning of servitude. And as such, they were called the servants of the most merciful. These are the ones. And among their titles is a kind of wish and dua that these people make all the time. وَالَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَاجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. They ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they say, O Allah, make our spouses, make our children a source of happiness for us. Why? Because this is the closest knit nucleus for all of us, our families. That's where we find solace, that's where we find happiness, that's where we find tranquility. But we find in today's age, look around us and you find many miserable people. The degree of divorce is so high. Why? Because we have deviated from the path that will lead to happiness and tranquility. These people who are the servants of the Most Merciful ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them that happiness. And what else? وَجْعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Help us to become leaders. For who? For the elite. For the elite of the believers. And that is the muttaqeen. So when we become leaders of the muttaqeen, we got it all. Because when you become a leader to the elite, you have reached the best level you can really seek. So asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to become a leader is something good. But to push yourself for a position of recognition is bad. So this is telling us to become a leader. You may wish for that, but you have to ask help from the one who will make you a leader. When Abu Dharr Al-Ghifari came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a good intention, said, Ya Rasulullah, make me a leader, use me. You know, I would like to help. He said it with good intention. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who did not appoint people simply to please them, to make them happy, he said, no, Abu Dharr, to become a leader requires certain qualities. Not everyone can become a leader. Leadership entails certain responsibilities and requires certain qualifications. And that is what we would like to talk about today. So I wanted to start by saying that wishing to become a leader is a good thing. But this wish has to go through the proper channel, and that is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who gives all things and the one who takes all things if we do not deserve them. So place this wish with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and start immediately to work at it. That is why you are today attending youth tarbiyah. What is tarbiyah? Tarbiyah is to work on that self in order to put it in the proper channel to acquire the things that will get you to where you want to get. Do you know where you want to get? Do you know where you're heading? Do you know what you want? Inshallah, all of us will agree that our goal is Jannah. And to get to Jannah, you've got to work hard at it. And among the many things that will inshallah take you quickly to Jannah is to work on your leadership skills. Number one, what are the elements of leadership? Islamic leadership, that is. Number one, you want to lead Muslims Islamically? I mean, let us just use examples. Military leadership, academic leadership, economic leadership, political leadership will require that. If you are a military leader, you've got to know about military rules. Academic leader, you've got to really earn a PhD or a DDS or an MD so that you can lead in that field. Political leader, you've got to know what politics are all about. Islamic leadership will require, number one, please write it down if you are writing. Number one, you've got to know Islam. You cannot just lead by opinion. You cannot just say, I feel so energetic and I'm a Muslim and I come to pray 5 times a day and I do all of that and I feel an urge inside me to lead, but I don't know enough about Islam. Well, I'll pick it up on the way. No, you can't do that. You cannot do that. Number one, if you want to provide proper leadership, you've got to know Islam. You've got to know the two sources of Islam, the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These two sources are not for barakah only, even though one of the sessions, as you will find, is Sunnah a source of barakah. But you know how this barakah will come to you when you really learn the Sunnah and live the Sunnah, so the barakah will come from within. You cannot just get the barakah simply by associating yourself with these two sources and say, I recognize them as the sources for my life as a Muslim. No, you've got to really go to the depth of these sources and learn them and live them. How many people really know the Quran? How many people know the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How many tarbiyah conferences are there to teach us the rules of dealing with the Quran, the rules of learning the Sunnah? Therefore, if you really want to become a leader, and it is, by the way, I don't want to mislead you by saying that leadership is just, if you wish to become, it's okay. No, today it's a necessity. It's a necessity. And what I mean by that, if we look at the Muslims in the world today, we find that we have deviated a great deal from the sources of Islamic knowledge that will bring us to where we want to be. That is Kitab Allah wa Sunnah Rasulih sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, تَرَكْتُ فِيكُمْ مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَمْ تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِيَ أَبَدًا. I am leaving with you two things which if you will hold fast to, you will never go astray after me. Kitab Allah, the book of Allah, and my Sunnah. When we look at ourselves today, are we properly guided? It doesn't take much to say no, we are not. We are all over the map, disagreeing with each other, pulling in different directions, just moving. For the simple reason that we have to, we are being pushed because we are not being tolerated. We don't know what to do. We don't know how to bring ourselves to the shore of peace. Why? Because simply Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us how we would be properly guided. So because we are not, then we have not paid heed to his advice. So we need to go back. No matter how long it will take, we need to go back to the Quran and the Sunnah. We need to study them. We need to spend hours every day. You are studying to be a lawyer, you are studying to be an engineer, fine. But at least 2 to 3 hours every day should be dedicated to the Quran and the Sunnah, to study them. To study them. And after that, inshallah, Allah will change the bad situation that we are in today. So this is number one element of Islamic leadership. Number two, to be a Muslim leader, you've got to be modest. You've got to be far from arrogance. You've got to understand that to be a leader is to be the servant to the community you are leading. As we know that the rule for Islamic leadership is the leader of the community is the servant of the community. Sayyidul Qawmi Khadimuhum. It is not a status symbol. It is not something that will make you sit in the front and people will sing your praises and say, you know, this and this. No. You've got to go, and you know, if you go back and study the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, once he was with a group of his companions on a journey and it was time for them to eat. And you know, all of them wanted Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to just sit and do nothing. He said, no, you do this, you do this, you do this, and I will go and collect the twigs to start the fire. And they looked at him, said, Rasulullah, you are... He said, no, I will do that. And when they were digging the ditch around Medina, or in one place of Medina, to defend Medina against the Ahzab, the Confederates, he was himself digging with everyone else. And people used to say that whenever they will come to his majlis, wherever he is sitting with his companions, people who did not know him would find it difficult to know who is Rasulullah, who is the leader of this group. They would not recognize him. And he would say to people, don't flatter me, don't raise me, don't make me as the Jews and the Christians used to do to their prophets. I am a human being like all of you. The only difference is that I received revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the kind of leader. This is the kind of leader who is never arrogant. Number three, a Muslim leader is a just leader. It's someone who is not partial. He is someone who is totally impartial. He is someone who will establish justice even though it is against himself, his parents, or his relatives. As we read in Al-Quran Al-Kareem, that you should establish justice even if it means that this justice will be against you for something you've done which is wrong. You've got to establish that. And a good Muslim leader is he who will say, I am sorry, I made a mistake. All of us will make mistakes. Why? Because in Islam, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that every child of Adam will make mistakes. And the best among those who make mistakes are those who repent. So a Muslim leader is someone who is focused, but he will make mistakes, and whenever that mistake is discovered, he will stand up and say, I am sorry, I made a mistake. Why? Because he is not afraid that by admitting the mistake, admitting what he did wrong, that his status will diminish. Because to start with, he doesn't recognize a status. There's nothing called a status associated with leadership. Leadership is service. And as such, when he makes a mistake, he will stand up and say it so that the others will learn from him. Number four, a Muslim leader is someone who is focused, someone who has a vision. Because when you want to take someone, let's say literally by the hand, to lead them to a certain goal, you want to get somewhere, you should know more than the one you are leading by the hand, because you know where you are getting. That other person is depending on your vision, on your focus. That person who is going with you may not know where you are getting, but because he or she had placed the trust in you, because you have the focus, they really will feel good, and they may not question at times where you are taking them. Actually, you know, this is something that we should all establish in the different circles of leadership that we should establish. And by the way, there are different circles of leadership. You, number one, have to be a good leader to your nafs. This is the first circle. You have to lead your nafs, because the nafs will always tend to run away from you and enjoy a path far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You've got to always go back and grab that nafs and do tarbiyah to that nafs, do tazkiyah to that nafs, so that you will bring it back, so that you will lead your nafs in the proper way. You've got to be a leader within the circle of your family if you are in that position. And you've just heard from the speaker who was before me that there are times for things. Whenever your father is the leader of the family, you've got to recognize that. And I always repeat this because I'm very proud of it. I had my doctorate degree and my father only reached grade 3. When I would be sitting with him and he would be speaking, I do not open my mouth until he points to me with his eyes, meaning you can say what you believe is the truth, and then I will talk. I wouldn't say, but I have a doctorate, I am doctor so and so, and I have to speak now. No, this is not what leadership is all about. I always, always gave him the responsibility that he had acquired through his position as the head of the family. Qawwamun. Qawwamun means that men, fathers, husbands
are in charge of their families. And being in charge does not require a PhD, does not require a master's, does not require a bachelor's from an academic institution, because there are people who are leaders without having to get that qualification from an academic institution. We know that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was not Professor Abu Bakr, or Dr. Abu Bakr, or Dr. Umar ibn al-Khattab, or Dr. Uthman ibn Affan. Yet they led the Ummah. They led the Ummah. Why? Because they got their ijazah, they got their certificate, they got their recognition, their diploma, through their association with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they learned the Quran and they learned the Sunnah. That's all the qualification they needed. That is why when I would recognize the leadership of my father, because he had acquired it through his knowledge of the Quran and the Sunnah. That's why I learned from him. And this is something which I would like to reiterate, to recognize where things are defined. When you are the leader in your work, you've got to understand that. When you are the leader in your community, you've got to understand that. When you are the leader of the country, you've got to understand that. Leadership has different circles, and you've got to really recognize that you need to be focused, you need to have that vision. You know, quite often, my children ask me, you know, Baba, where are we getting? And if I don't have time at the time, they just don't repeat their question. They know that I am doing the best for them. So I've got to be focused. I've got to do what is, and because of this, I've got to spend time doing that. Number five, quality. Even though I am focused, I have the vision, I think I know where I'm heading, number five should be my preparedness to consult. Consultation, shura, wa amruhum shura baynahum. This is a principle of leadership in Islam that we cannot bypass. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even told the one, if there is anyone who did not need to consult with anyone, it's Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, wa shawirhum fil amr. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ. He said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, imagine Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would consult with others who could very well not know even one iota of what he already knows. Yet, to teach them the proper leadership, because he is the example of leadership for us, he used to consult with them. And at times, he would actually take his human dimension, even though that spiritual, divine dimension that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opened for him to recognize where he is getting, he will put that on hold, he will take that human dimension, and he will say, let us camp here. And then Al-Miqdad will come to him and say, Ya Rasulullah, with lots of adab, with lots of manners, he said, is it a place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked you to use for camping, or is it your own choice? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would respond by saying, no, it is my own choice. And then he would say, then, O Messenger of Allah, I would suggest such and such. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let's do that. So that there will be that element of consultation, that element of feeling that, oh no, we are not just being led without giving us the opportunity to express our opinion. So I say to the leaders, those who would like to assume that great responsibility of leadership, even though you feel you know where you're heading, but you should consult with others. But look at that addendum that comes with consultation, which takes us to number six as the element of Islamic leadership. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. You should be strong enough as a leader not to let things, because of consultation, just go loose. Because people have the tendency, whenever you ask them, each one will pull in a different, no, I want this. The leader will know when that consultation matures to pull everybody back again and say, now is the time. I listened to all of you, and I took your suggestion. You have invested in me the responsibility of leadership. Inshallah, we will do this. And he should say it with determination, not with a wishy-washy stand, because those who are being led, if they feel that the stand is wishy-washy, next time they will feel insecure, because this person is not determined to take us where we are supposed to go. This is Islamic leadership. And this is the sixth element of leadership that we should be prepared to proceed, because sometimes you may have to make a decision very quickly. You cannot wait. And that is what we really have to recognize. When people say, you know, in Islam, men are really everything in Islam. Women are not important. And they go ahead and they quote الرِّجَالُ قَوَّبُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, that men are in a position of leadership over women, without knowing what Islamic leadership is all about. You know, when the husband assumes the responsibility of leadership, it's a huge responsibility being placed on his shoulders. And the responsibility, it's not a matter of just being, you know, recognized as so great, because if he makes the wrong decision, he has to accept that responsibility because of his decision. But let us go back, he has to consult with his wife. And there are many elements in the Quran that point where consultation between husband and wife, when it comes even, you know, to weaning the child, you know, the baby, they consult with each other. They talk about matters concerning their children. They consult about everything. But then the husband has to say, okay, I've got to make that decision. We've got to go ahead and do what is right. So now, brothers and sisters, let us move. How much, brother, do I have to? 10 minutes. Okay. Now, to move to another element of Islamic leadership. A Muslim leader, number 7, has to have a high degree of endurance. Of endurance. A Muslim leader is not a weak leader. A Muslim leader should endure negative forces that are bound to be there. Never expect as a leader to be free of negative criticism. And I stress negative criticism, because criticism is good. Criticism is an element that should be taken to correct our path. So I say negative criticism. If we cannot tolerate negative criticism, if we will start to feel sorry for ourselves and we will fall under that criticism, we are not good leaders. We shouldn't assume that responsibility. A good leader should also have physical endurance, because since he is the, you know, the servant of the community, a leader is not someone who will tell others what to do and then go home and sleep and then say, expect everybody tomorrow to have done this and this. I will come to this as number 8, inshallah, but let me come to endurance. Person who's a leader should be the first at the head of the group. You know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the battlefield used to be at the head of the group fighting with the non-believers. Only, you know, we remember at Uhud when he was struck by the non-believers, it was a spontaneous reaction from the Muslims to go and make a shield around him, to cover him. He didn't ask for that. He wanted to continue to be like everybody, but they threw themselves around him so that they will protect him with their bodies, with their souls, with their lives, because that was a reflection of how much they loved him. But Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was at the head of any delegation that had to go and do some work. He was always there to do the work. And he had that endurance. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not tell people to pray and do zakat and this and that and then say, sit home and do nothing. Actually, You know, one time Abdullah ibn Umar woke up in the middle of the night and he walked by the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in the darkness of the night he saw something that looked like a tree trunk, a palm tree trunk. He said, I never recognized that that trunk was there. I don't know what placed it there. And he came closer, closer, closer. When he became close enough, he recognized that that motionless, supposedly tree trunk was none other than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam standing in salat. And he stood behind him and he said, this is my chance now to be praying behind Rasulullah by myself, no one else. Imagine, just close your eyes and imagine that you will go back in history and you are given the chance to pray behind Rasulullah by yourself. How would you feel? How would you feel? So it was his chance and he stood. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam read from Surah Al-Baqarah. He reached ayah 100, okay? And then, you know, then Abdullah said, okay, now he's going to do ruku'. He didn't. He continued. He finished Surah Al-Baqarah. He said, that's it. Now he's going to do ruku'. He didn't. He went into Surah Ali Imran. And then at the end of Surah Ali Imran, he said, now he's going to do it. He went into Surah Al-Nisa. You know, and he sat. He couldn't. He couldn't. Why? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given that endurance. Okay? And the endurance that he was given, he used to join fasting. And he said that for you, don't ever try to do that because you cannot. إِنِّي أَبِيتُ يُطْعِمُنِي اللَّهُ وَيُسْقِينِي. He said that, don't ever try to do that because I can join one day with another, with another, with another fasting because Allah will provide me with nourishment. He gave him that endurance and he would use it without anybody looking at him because he was a leader. He was a leader. And then I go now to number 8. When you have that physical endurance, you shouldn't try to isolate yourself from the responsibility of recognizing the limitations of those whom you are leading. You have to be of mercy on those people. You've got to recognize that they really do not have your qualities, and that's why you are the leader and they are being led. You've got to show mercy towards those people. You've got to show mercy. And when you show mercy towards those people, if they come with their criticism and you say, you know, why are they saying, what do they know? No, you should recognize that people are on a spectrum. Some know very little and you've got to recognize them for what they know, and others, you know a lot and you've got to recognize them for who they are. You know, brothers and sisters, how often I know after khutbas, after, you know, people come to me and I know that they don't know enough in Islam, let me say, and I listen and I say, inshallah, I will try. But if there is a mistake, I say, let's sit and talk about it. You've got to be prepared not to hurt people's feelings simply because you are the imam. How dare anybody come to the imam and correct him? But at the same time, since we are talking here about adab, when you come to express an opinion and give criticism, you've got to be mu'addab. You've got to be gentle. You've got to have a proper niyyah and say, Ya Allah, my intention of giving that criticism is to please you, O Allah. So help me to do it properly. Help me to do it properly. Brothers and sisters, you know, I said negative criticism and I said positive criticism. Now, negative criticism is not recommended. Why? Because it's only interested in putting people down. Positive criticism is something that we should always invite. Ask people, you know, what do you think? Let's have sessions of evaluation. What do you say about what we did and what happened? So this is Number 8, brothers and sisters. Now, number 9, as an element of leadership, is to know where to start and where to end. By knowing that, by recognizing that this is the end of my responsibility, I should now hand over the responsibility of leadership to someone else. This is what is really, you know, Islamic. However, let me mention this. In Islam, this comes at a time when you feel that you started to lose some of the qualifications of leadership. In Islam, it is not necessarily a fixed term. As long as you possess those qualities and you are the best among the group possessing that quality, you can continue. As long as you are not doing it for enjoyment, I am the leader, don't dare to take it away from me. No, go back to the other elements that I mentioned. You have to have humility, you should not be arrogant, you should be capable, you should have endurance, you should have the focus of justice, all of that. Once you start to feel physically tired, unable to make the right decisions and this and that, then you should step down. Otherwise, you know, and people criticize us, they put as a standard, they say, democracy. You know, as if democracy in the understanding of the West is the criterion. Everything else is no good. We say no. We should examine the elements of leadership in Islam and say that leadership is not something that we just steal from others. It's something that is a responsibility, not a privilege. It's a responsibility. And that is why we go to number 10 as an element of leadership. And please remember that. If you know that you have... Jazakallah khair. If you know, and please listen to me, we need to recognize this 10th element of leadership, brothers and sisters. If you know that you possess all the elements of leadership and you do not accept the responsibility, you will be asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. You will be asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment. If people approach you, did I say people approach you? Yes. Because brothers and sisters, let's now go from 10 to 11 and make them together. Because we have to understand them together. According to Islamic etiquette of leadership, you cannot come forward and say, I feel that I have all the qualities of leadership, I want to be your leader. You can't do that. You cannot do that. Even though you possess everything, you cannot do that. You know why? Because shaitan will grab one of the elements and squeeze it out of you, and that is the element of humility. I hope you understand that. He will grab that element out, so you lost one of the major elements of leadership, and then you don't have everything. But what you should do, you should work as a paratrooper. You should work, you know, as someone in the community until, if Allah so wishes, He will bring you to the surface so that people will definitely recognize that. They will come to you and they say, we would like you to be our leader. And then if you know you possess all the elements, you should say, I am ready. Remember the story of Khalid ibn al-Walid and Abu Ubaidah, Amr ibn al-Jarrah. Two great military leaders who possessed the qualities of leadership, yet we don't spend the time to really go and study their characters. If you would recognize what happened in association with a third leader called Umar ibn al-Khattab, who really was such a leader, Umar ibn al-Khattab, that his leadership style was taught in Europe until the last century. I know that in Italy, in law schools, they used to teach an 80-page booklet about the leadership of Umar ibn al-Khattab. And by the way, there is a book that a non-Muslim put together about the 100 most influential personalities throughout history. We know by now that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was number one. That non-Muslim in that book, the most influential 100 people throughout history, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was number one. You know, number 56 was Umar ibn al-Khattab. 56 was Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab, when he became the leader of the Muslim community, it was Umar ibn al-Khattab, out of a sense of responsibility, who brought forward the title of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was not called Amir al-Mu'mineen. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was called Khalifat Rasulullah. It was Umar ibn al-Khattab, out of a sense of understanding for his responsibility, that brought forward a title that continued throughout Islamic history. Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers. And when he put these together, he understood his responsibility. When he assumed leadership, the Muslims were fighting a very decisive battle with the Romans. And things were so serious, that any defeat for the Muslims could have spelled great disaster for the Muslims. At that serious moment, look at the leader, Umar ibn al-Khattab, sending a letter to Khalid ibn al-Walid, who was the leader of the Muslim army, and said, "Ya Khalid, when you receive my message, my letter, you should step down and you should ask Abu Ubaida Amr ibn al-Jarrah to take over the leadership." Umar ibn al-Khattab, signature. He didn't justify, didn't tell him nothing. Khalid ibn al-Walid was the Muslim leader that we put throughout Islamic history that was never defeated, even before he became a Muslim, and after he became Muslim, never defeated. Imagine if he did not get Islam into his heart, how would somebody feel as a military leader that never lost a battle in his life? Actually, his planning of the battle of Al-Yarmouk is being taught until today in military colleges on how to plan a battle. His maneuver with the Romans when they had 214 fighters against the 12,000, 214,000 against the 12,000 of the Muslims. What will happen? They will eat them alive. But it was Khalid ibn al-Walid who planned how the Muslims should leave and go to Syria with the least amount of casualties. And they still teach that in military, because he was a genius in military maneuvering. Khalid ibn al-Walid receiving a letter from Umar ibn al-Khattab telling him, when you receive it, you ask Abu Ubaidah to become the leader. He just waited. Or actually, you know, I messed it up a little bit. The letter was sent to Abu Ubaida Amr ibn al-Jarrah to assume the leadership. Abu Ubaida Amr ibn al-Jarrah kept the letter from Umar ibn al-Khattab as a secret. Why? Because he knew that Khalid ibn al-Walid was about to finish the most decisive element of the battle. He didn't tell him. He didn't say, "Hey, Khalid ibn al-Walid, get to the side. I'm the leader now." No, he said, "There's something very important now." He kept that message as a secret until things cleared up a little bit. With great deal of humility, he came. It was the Amir al-Mu'mineen. He couldn't really
you know, disobey, gave it to Khadim al-Walid. Khadim al-Walid said, سَمْعًا وَطَاعَةً لِأَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And he stepped aside, and Abu Ubaidah became the leader. So Khalid ibn al-Walid, he knew when to step down. He knew how to recognize the levels of leadership. So this is very important for us to recognize. Number 12, brothers and sisters, as an element of leadership. In Islam, age is not recognized when it comes to leadership. You can be as young as you want. If you are the one in the group who possesses all the elements of leadership and you are the youngest, you can be the leader. Age is no element. So please recognize that. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asking or was consulting with his companions, he wanted to send a leader to Yemen to become his representative in Yemen. He started to ask, what's your qualification? What will make you a good leader? What will make you a good leader? What will make you... Until a young companion, no older than 21 years of age, came to him and he said, Ya Rasulullah, I know everything about Surah Al-Baqarah. He said, you are the leader. Take it. Imagine Surah Al-Baqarah. Everything about Surah Al-Baqarah. He said, you are the leader. And he was 21 years old. And there were people who were in their 60s and 70s. But he gave it to him. You know Usama ibn Zayd. He was 17 years old when he led an army, among which within the army was Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, Umar ibn al-Khattab, were under his leadership, because age is not an element. And there's a very interesting anecdote. When Umar bin Abdul Aziz, who is usually referred as the fifth of the Khulafa al-Rashideen, when Umar bin Abdul Aziz assumed the leadership of the believers, people from all over the Muslim land came to congratulate him, to, you know, offer their, you know, allegiance, to tell him that they are prepared to follow his leadership. And a delegation entered the place where Umar bin Abdul Aziz was sitting. And the leadership of that delegation was given to a young boy who was no older than 12 years of age. And with that delegation were older people. And so Umar bin Abdul Aziz, you know, said, Ya Fata, oh young man, young boy, why don't you step aside and let your elders speak? That young boy looked at Umar and he said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, O leader of believers, if leadership is recognized because of age, there are many people in the Muslim land who are much older than you. But it is not recognized by a 12 years old talking to a 31 years old, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, and telling him, if it is age, then there are many people who are much older than you. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz said, you are right. Now you can talk. He reminded him of that. Okay. Now, I would like to wrap it up, brothers and sisters, by starting to talk, you know, present day situation. Brothers and sisters, the Muslim world today is boiling. The whole world is boiling. The world is becoming a very dangerous place to live in. And Muslims are being targeted. Not only that, already that target is being used and they are aiming already at that target. And many casualties are starting to fall.
many Muslims in Britain, in the States, in Canada, in other parts of the world are being denied their civil liberties because they are displaying their Islamic identities. Many Muslims are being denied the right to dress as the Quran and the Sunnah tell them to dress. Many Muslims are being denied the right to study the programs that are taken out of the Quran and the Sunnah under the premise that the Quran is anti-Semitic. Many things are happening in the world today that require the kind of leadership that we draw directly from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was subjected to all kinds of difficulties, to all kinds of situations, which if they would be presented to us today, we would stand totally perplexed, not knowing what to do and how to respond to them. But he taught us what to do. All we have to do is to go to number one element that I mentioned, to study his example, to study his example, and learn how did he do things, and then try to deal with our situation. We need leaders from among you. We need people who will go a little beyond, inshallah. I'm so proud every time I hear Hafiz so-and-so, Hafiz so-and-so, I say, La ilaha illallah. This is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. In 7 months, a youngster, a Muslim, committed the Quran to memory. In 7 months. I mean, if you tell anybody that Muslims can do that, a book, huge book, in 7 months, they say it's impossible. Say, yes, in your books it is impossible. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرِ. You know, in Surah Al-Qamar, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that we made it easy for those who want to commit it to memory. Are there among those of you who would like to do that? If they do, we will help them. So when you get help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you don't need any other help. All the other rules will fall apart because they will not work, because the rule of Allah will work, will take over. But you need determination. If you have that determination to assume leadership, many of the, if not all of them, were born in Canada. They know much better the realities of this land. They know what it's like if they will have Islam as their driving force to lead the rest of us. It doesn't matter how much I will go and spend time to study Islam and say I would like to lead, I still have an accent. I still have a background that is not in Canada. I will still have many things that I will not be able to come to terms with because of my background. And that is why we come forward and we say, let's share our Islam with you so that you can take over and lead us in the West, inshallah, according to the principles of Islam. That's why in the Youth Tarbiyah Conference, it is most befitting, quite necessary, very important to talk about leadership. Because if we do not move in yourselves the urge to move forward and make the dua that Ibadur Rahman, as I started with, make to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبَّنَا هَبْ لَنَا مِنْ أَزْوَاجِنَا وَذُرِّيَّاتِنَا قُرَّةَ أَعْيُنٍ وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. I would like to end with what I started with by asking you to join with me in making this dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَجَعَلْنَا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ إِمَامًا. Make the dua with determination. O Allah, make us leaders for the righteous. And Allah will help you. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I would like to do that, but there are some people and possibly scholars who have gone to the extent of claiming it necessary to have a teacher teach the Quran to a student. They say that it is wrong to study the Quran with the meaning plus commentary alone because a person may go astray. Yes, brother, you know, when I say every day you spend 2 to 3 hours studying the Quran, I did not mean that you do it alone. Obviously, you know, you do not go through medical school without having tutors and teachers and instructors. Yes, there is a great deal of you know, freedom given in modern curricula in our medical faculties, but we do insist that tutors, professors do go through lectures, help explain. And the same thing goes for the Quran and the Sunnah. You cannot learn the inner meanings and things without having a teacher. Imagine that you do not know anything called nasikh and mansukh, the abrogated and what abrogates certain ayat. It is all revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you read a certain ayah and say, see, I read it in the Quran, without knowing that this particular ayah has been abrogated by another ayah. So you really need a teacher. If you will read a hadith from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam without knowing the level of authenticity, without knowing the chain of transmission, without knowing what is sahih, what is hasan, what is da'if, what is mursal, what is marfu', what is, and the different significance of each of these categories, you may make conclusions that are not based on what is authentic. So I would definitely stress the need for a teacher. So you may meet with this teacher twice a week, once a week, once a month. You will get an assignment, you go every day, you study, prepare, so that when you meet with the teacher, it's like being, you know, in an informal school. Jazakumullah khair for the question. Now we hear a lot about Islam and democracy and how they are related, if they are. Some say there's no democracy in Islam, while others say the opposite. Would you please shed some light on how a leader is chosen in Islamic State under Islamic law? How do we ordinary people contribute towards choosing the leader? See, the mistake, and I repeat what I said in my presentation, the mistake we make is that we use democracy as the criterion. And if we discover that Islam meets the standard of democracy, we cheer up and we feel good that the world is going to welcome us now into the world of civilization because we have democracy in Islam. This is wrong. Democracy, and there are many thinkers who say that democracy is not the answer to many of the problems today. So we have to be very careful. And if we say that democracy has certain Islamic flavor to it, it's different than saying that Islam has democracy. These are two different things. We have to study the system of leadership in Islam and how justice is manifested without really having to subscribe to other principles that the world is comfortable with today. That does not mean that we should be in a different camp than the rest of the world today. No, it is our duty to advance Islamic knowledge to the world and let them appreciate the Islamic alternative without being too confrontational. This is my suggestion. Now, how do Muslims choose a leader in an Islamic State? We have many examples. You know, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was chosen by a majority, quote-unquote, vote. The majority of Muslims went to Saqifat Bani Sa'ida and they chose Abu Bakr as the leader of the Muslims. Now, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, you know, the way that he chose his successor, he appointed Umar ibn al-Khattab as the most worthy successor to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Umar ibn al-Khattab chose a group of six people, six elders, six people who possessed the leadership qualities, and he said, you meet and you choose one of you as the next leader. And he made it such a serious thing. He said that if they fail after a few days, then you should just
cut their heads. Now, obviously, that was an extreme measure which meant to the people that you should really meet on one common principle and choose the leader from among you. So there are different models that lead to choosing a leader, but let us remember that a leader in a Muslim state is not someone who will say, I want to be your leader, so appoint me. You cannot ask to be a leader. You have to be acclaimed by either a majority or by a group of people in the community. Are women allowed to be leaders? This is what we really, you know, the combination of words is what is common among people. Are women allowed? You see the word allowed? What kind of connotation? What kind of feeling does it elicit? Allowed, this is the word. Which means that if they are not allowed, it means that they are not privileged, that they are not as good as men. And then we say to be leaders, which means that to be leader is something great, is the ultimate in achievements in this world. Yes, I said Ibadur Rahman, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help them to be lilmuttaqina imama. It's something that is a responsibility. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the qualities, you should thank Him, because you would have earned that by having all the prerequisites of leadership that will put you in a position that is really tough to be in. So to be a leader is not something that we should really look at as a kind of recognition or pleasant status symbol. No, in Islam it is not like that. Therefore, when we say are women allowed to be leader, we have to understand why women are not given that leadership. Because if you will examine the 12 elements of leadership that I gave you, let's say a high degree of endurance, both physical and psychological. If we will have the leadership entailing religious leadership as well, we find that women, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them unable to assume that religious leadership, so to speak, during certain time of the month. And that during that time, they are emotionally unable to make the tough decisions that are required sometimes on the spur of the moment. So it is not something actually that is being taken away from them, but it is actually, they are placed within a household in a position where through a back door, so to speak, they are given the role of consultation that in 90% of the things related to the household, through a process called consultation, they are the ones who determine what the final outcome is. Because they are more knowledgeable in many of the things concerning the household than the man who spends most of the time outside. But he consults, they give the consultation, and the decision is made. So, are we after the final outcome, or are we after who is going to be responsible for that final outcome so that he or she will be recognized for that? Obviously, we are more interested as Muslims in the outcome, not the one who had participated in making that outcome. Muslims really have to look that it is the Jannah that we are seeking, not who will be the leader in this dunya. No, we have division of labor, division of positions, so that in the end we will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our youth is completely, you know, and this is something I'd like to say. I know I will be treading in a minefield, but I like to take difficult jobs. Our youth is completely mesmerized in physical aspect, a fashion parade of sunnah. Instead of the spirit of sunnah, which leads us to Quran, how long are we going to be entangled in these physical shows? I understand what the question means, that quite often we become entrapped in the physical show that we like to display all the things that we learn from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we heard, you know, our ulama talk about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a model for all of us, both in the physical display of identity as well as how he behaved. I would like to say that the physical display is very important, because quite often a Muslim is recognized. I was driving with my brother, you know, Samir, on the 401, and we saw a brother with, you know, the Islamic dress. I said, subhanAllah, you know, you look through the window and you see, you know, you recognize that he's a Muslim just the way he looked. Okay, but we should not only stress that, or we should not start with that and then work on the inner self.
No, we should go hand in hand. But quite often, and I may say for those who really criticize the physical display or parade as they called it, you know something, when you join, let's say, the military academy to learn the military rules to become an officer, they give you your uniform to put on even though you don't know anything about military things, so that later on you will really know everything about what's in the... When you become a judge, you don't have all the experience to become a judge, but they give you the robe and things to look like a judge. When you become an imam, with experience, you will develop everything that the imam will do. However, you know, you need that physical look in the beginning so that you will continue. So don't be too harsh in calling this a physical parade of things. We have to dress like Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We have to have the beard. We have to dress with the hijab. We have to really dress in such a modest way so that we will continue, inshallah, to seek what comes afterwards. I think I exhausted my time, and you really need to listen to the real ulama.